Okay, welcome back, everybody. We are shifting gears and moving into white dwarfs as hosts of planetary systems. And we'll have three talks in this session. Like, the first one will be an overview by Eva Villaver. And then we will have Chris Munzer talking about gauges, debris disks around white dwarfs. And then a talk by Ben Kaiser and Mark Hollands about the detection of lithium accreted in the form of planetesimals. Eva, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Okay, so I'll follow Ken in giving you a 1 minute warning if I see that you're not yet quite at the end. And yeah, just take it away.
Okay. Hello, everybody. I'm going to give an overview of why we care about planets around white dwarfs. I mean, we all know that we live in the era of astrophysics where that started when the first planet was discovered orbiting a sun-like star. And despite the fact that we right now know more than 4,000 planetary systems, we still have many things to understand on the planet formation and evolution, and that's where white dwarfs become handy. Again, last year, despite all the bad news we had a very good one, and it's the discovery of the first planet candidate transiting a white dwarf. And just hope that this is not the last, because we can learn a lot about what is going on in the systems from very few objects. The planet formation process is thought to be produced by the coalescence of small pieces in a protoplanetary disk. The initial conditions, viscosity, metal content, and so on, give rise to a variety of planetary systems that we observe. Eventually, the star evaporates all the remaining gas, the migration is halted, and we end up with the planetary systems that we observe in the main sequence. But we don't know the composition of the material, the planet formation beyond the typical, prototypical mass star, which is one solar mass star in the main sequence. And there are many things that we can learn from observations on white dwarfs. For example, we all are aware that the broken up remnants of exoasteroids, moon, planets, or whatever, have been seen for many years already in the photospheres of white dwarfs. These measurements allow to determine the composition of the planetary building blocks in a way that we cannot do with anything else besides picking up rocks on our own planet. And recently we found, as I mentioned before, we have found the first planet, something that we've been looking for years. But let's start with the problem. What is the problem with planets around white dwarfs? Well, the problem is stellar evolution. Before we observe the white dwarf, we have to account for stars going through two giant phases, where with one of them having substantial mass loss, a planetary nebula with big irradiation, and planetary systems are going to experience the consequences of the stellar evolution at these stages. So we cannot go from the main sequence, which is where the planetary building blocks that we observe in the photospheres of these white dwarfs are observed. We cannot go from one place to the other having a shortcut. We have to account for the full stellar evolution in order to provide educated guesses of what can we find out there. We have red giant, asymptotic giant branch phases. Most of the mass loss happens on the asymptotic giant branch. Then we have the planetary nebula phase with very high luminosities of the star and strong UV fluxes. And then we finally make it into the white dwarf phase. So let's see what may happen to a planetary system orbiting one of the stars here. I show the evolution of the radius of the star in red with time, and initial orbit from a putative planet orbiting one of these red giant stars. Here, the key is tidal evolution. Even though the planet doesn't make it to the surface of the star because of initial orbital distances that prevents this, what happens is tidal tides make a very strong push in the orbit. I mean, we have dissipation of the orbital energy because we have a fully convective star, and eventually the planet plugs in into the star. The change of the orbit here is not strongly affected by the mass loss of the star because in the red giant, the mass loss is very small. But we have to follow the evolution of the star. Even if the planet survived the red giant phase, we have still the asymptotic giant branch. We have fully convective star. Most of the mass loss happens during this period. And we have here, for example, evolution around 3.5 solar mass stars of different initial orbits of planets. On the top panel on the left, we have one Jupiter mass star, one Jupiter planet. And on the bottom, we have an Earth mass planet. We can compute what is the final orbit that these planets are going to have due to tidal evolution and mass loss for different masses. And different authors have done this kind of calculations. And as a consequence of that, we have a very strong guess and constraint based on the stellar evolution and what are the orbits that are allowed for planets when the star makes it to the white dwarf. And what we have, according to this model, single stellar evolution with a single planet, is that we have a gap. We cannot find anything around a white dwarf if we follow just stellar evolution. So this is a problem because we have known for years that material is being delivered to the surface of the white dwarf. So the question is, how can we bring material close to the white dwarf to explain white dwarf pollution? We need gravitational assistance. We can keep, stellar evolution, in fact, allows that. We can keep material, fragments of asteroids, moons, fragments of planets far away from the star, or several AU, and then add a major planet to perturb the orbit. And there has been a body of work trying to accomplish this task, trying to deliver material to the white dwarf at the rates that has been observed. And different modelers have taken different approaches. For example, Bonsor took a planet in a circular orbit with a Kuiper belt. Deves used emotional resonances on asteroid belts, or Fruen single planet with varying changing the eccentricity and the mass. The main conclusion of these works is that low mass planet with high eccentricity can do the work, but in principle we need massive disks in order to provide the accretion rates that are observed on the white dwarf phase. A planet in a circular orbit also cannot do it. So can we move forward from that? I mean, we have established mechanisms that can deliver material to the surface of the white dwarf, but now we have planets. We have a giant planet in transit discovered last year, and 2 years ago, a giant planet that is put there as an accretor in order to explain the observations. Bringing planets or bringing material is a different thing. We need more stuff to bring a planet close to the surface of the white dwarf. In fact, we need multiple planets or multiple stars or common envelope evolution in order to provide a mechanism that fills this gap that stellar evolution is leaving with evolution of the systems. So let's start with the multiple planetary systems and what they can do in order to deliver planets or material close to the white dwarf. We have a basic principle, and is that planetary systems, multiple planetary systems that are stable on the main sequence due to the mass loss that the star experiences mostly on the asymptotic giant branch phase, can become unstable on the white dwarf. So this is the stability behavior approximate for three planets of equal mass, Jupiter masses, that was computed a few years ago by Mustil et al. And following the pioneer work of the Deves et al. If different flavors of this kind of simulations provide different solutions for this, one of the main and main conclusions that remains valid for most of the works is that the main output of these instabilities of multiple planetary systems when the planet makes it to the white dwarf is that ejection is the most common effect. I mean, we have collisions of the planet with the star, which are the ones that, that we like in order to provide a theoretical framework in order to explain the accretion of material into the white dwarf, or the possibility of having a planet close to the star. But we see here that changing the stellar mass or the setup of the system basically provides the same effect. Most of the outcomes of instability are ejections. And this is normal because we end up with a white dwarf with a very low mass. Mustil et al. Try a different, slightly different approach of this mechanism. What they build is a system of multiple planets, in particular three planets, and they put an asteroid belt either inside of the planetary orbit or outside of the planetary orbit. And one of the basic things that they find is that the efficiency of delivery increases with decreasing the planet mass. And this seems to be a common trend. I mean, the lower the mass of the planet that we put there, the higher the efficiency and the better they are in order to deliver material to the white dwarf. And despite the high efficiency with which material is delivered to the Roche limit compared to the white dwarf surface, the trend is similar with time for the different masses of the planet that have been considered in this work. Here is some recent work of a PhD thesis of Maldonado et al. That shows how multiple planets can reach close to the Roche limit of the white dwarf, which is marked on the dashed line on the bottom of this plot. And different colors are different planets and different outcomes of, I mean, this is one system that has been evolved to the white dwarf phase with five planets. And we see that we have ejections here in pink. And the interesting parts are the planets are the green and blue that make it inside the Roche lobe of the star, where they can get trapped with circularized orbits, or they can be broken the tidal limit of the white dwarf. In fact, this work shows, if I can change the I don't know what's going on, but doesn't let me change. Here it is. So this is the comparison of the fraction of systems that become unstable when two, three, four, five, and six planetary systems are considered. And the main result of this work is the higher the multiplicity of the planets that are considered, the higher the fraction of the systems that become stable and therefore are going to either get close to the white dwarf Roche lobe or deliver material there. So multiplicity is a plus, low mass planets are good. Let's see what happens with binaries. Binaries can be used as perturbers or can be have been also checked in order to understand whether the material that is observing the surface of the white dwarf could be delivered by basically the wind of a closed star. The conclusion is no. The binary distance of accretion is very short, and these kind of binaries are not found there. But the binary can be used as a perturber in order to deliver things close to the white dwarf. In fact, this is the mechanism that has been proposed in order to explain the presence of the planet, let's call it the planet, the coolest planet we found on a white dwarf yet. It has a period of 1.4 days, and cosine migration has been invoked by several works because this system happens to be in a quadrupole system. There are two stars nearby of the order 600 AU that can excite the cosylid of mechanism and bring this planet close to the white dwarf. Other cool things that the binaries can do is what has been proposed by Crater a few years ago. And it's because of the presence of the binary, once star evolves, the stability limit of the planet that is orbiting one of the stars can get modified, and as a consequence, the whole system evolves in a chaotic matter. The planet can be ejected, can collide with the star, or can be either sent to the other star and orbit the secondary or primary. Other things that can bring planets or can provide planets close to a white dwarf, given the fact that we basically open a gap with stellar evolution, is engulfment. And here we have the key of common envelope evolution that has been used in previous phases of the star in order to explain things like high rates of rotation in red giant branch stars, magnetic fields enhancement, and so on and so forth. So these works prove that the engulfment of a planet can do a lot of cool stuff into stellar evolution, and things that basically we have problems understanding if we don't invoke the presence of something that has been shallow, something that provides angular momentum into the star, basically. And also, an important fact, something very important to remember, is that once we enter into common envelope, we have two possible outcomes. We may end up with a stable binary system if we provide enough energy to the envelope of the star in order to eject this envelope. And this is here the key is when and where in the envelope the planet or the second body enters, because the binding energy of the envelope changes orders of magnitude whether the star has a radius or another, basically whether the star is in one phase or the other. So there is a lot of fine-tuning to do in order to provide the ejection of the envelope with common envelope. The most likely outcome of these systems is because the orbital evolution runs very fast once the planet enters into the envelope is emerging. And in fact, this kind of common envelope phase has been used in order to explain the presence of hot sub-dwarf planets or the ejection of envelopes in these systems in order to explain the existence of these very hot stars that have lost a lot of mass that shouldn't be provided on the red giant branch phase. Post-common envelope binaries have been found to have planets, and in fact, one very key parameter to prove with these planetary systems is the common envelope efficiency and time scale. And that's something that we can constrain very well, because if we have the detections, if we have the observations, we have to basically rewind in time and provide models that use different common efficiency parameters and timescales of evolution in order to basically fit the observations. This has been done in the planet, this this planet has been found to be evaporated at 15 solar radius from this white dwarf by Boris et al.
Eva, just very quick, you've got about a minute left.
Yeah, I'm on time. And here we can see that on the black line and the dashed lines are different parameters of the common envelope ejection efficiency. And by having this kind of plots and this kind of educated guesses of what may the common envelope evolution in order to have this planet close to the white dwarf may provide, we can provide constraints on this common envelope phase. This kind of model has been done also in order to explain the planet in the 1.4 day orbit, just invoking the survivor of a common envelope. So basically, for this planet, we have different mechanisms that can explain its existence. We know that evolution of the star provides a gap, and this is something that seems that pretty well established. So in order to bring material close to the white dwarf, we either do it with multiple planetary systems. We need high multiplicity, and this kind of mechanism is very efficient for low mass planets and eccentric orbits. We may have binary stars providing excitation in order to break and bring the planet there, either also with cosi, or we may have common envelope evolution. The good thing or bad thing is that all three can explain this planet that has just been found, because it is in a particular configuration. In fact, it has a pair of binaries orbiting very nearby. If we find other planets and they are not in triple systems, maybe we can provide better constraints in what are the mechanisms that can bring material close to the white dwarf, because in this case, a cosi will not be able to be invoked. So with this, I just finish the talk. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there questions for Eva?
I see one.
I can't see if anybody has their hands up. Maybe we give people just another second to think about questions. Alex, you need to unmute yourself. Yes, okay.
For the post-common envelope planets, I mean, do we expect that the planets undergo evaporation after the time of the common envelope, and or could we expect that they have preserved their mass?
It's very hard for a planet to enter into an envelope and preserve the mass. So, in fact, there is a mass limit in which you basically evaporate the whole planet within a few orbits. So, in order to observe the planet out there, it has to be much more massive than the observed one. Unless there is a lot of fine-tuning in order to eject the envelope at the very, very quickly when it has very low binding energy and so on and so forth. But as soon as the planet gets into the envelope, it's going to be evaporated and it's going to be eroded. So very quickly.
And just then as a follow-up, so does it make it more difficult to constrain the common envelope parameters that way? Because common envelope parameters depend on the mass of the planet and the mass of the core of the giant.
I think constraining common envelope parameters is very hard anyway. So whatever information we may add, basically with this kind of planets, is going to help, because we have different systems than the ones that are traditionally used to do common envelope evolution models. And they already have the problems too, that they don't know what is the before, they know the after. So we are in the same kind of situation, but here we may add a little bit of more information.
Thank you.
I have a question. Do you think that the common envelope evolution could affect the chemical composition of a planet, of a giant planet?
I never thought of that, but the accretion rate onto the surface of the planet is going to be very high, but you are going to have a lot of evaporation. So probably it depends on what wins at the end when the envelope is ejected. If you retain some of the composition you get kind of dirty once the envelope gets ejected, yes. But one has to see what will win in this game.
Okay, thanks. JJ.
I want to stick with the common envelope planets just for a second. And that is, are there any that are like extremely robust conformations? I know most of the post-common envelope planets are claimed from eclipse timing variations, which can come from a number of reasons, especially the white dwarf M-dwarf binaries. They seem to do whatever they want to do over long timescales. And so can you plant your flag on any of the post-common envelope binaries and say, this almost certainly has a planet? I mean, I know NNSIR has been one of those systems that has seemed to follow models, but over the last few years, even that seems to be a little washy. So I'm just wondering if it could be that all of these post-common envelope planets really aren't there and there's some other effect, physical effect.
To me, an answer was the strongest case, even though we found with models that shouldn't be there. So even though it was we were arguing against its existence because we will need to invoke very, very extreme common envelope parameters in order for it to be there. It seemed until a couple of years ago the strongest case for a reality of existence of a planet. So, yes, there are problems in the systems. The same as we are having problems with red giant brown stars and then very massive planets that are being found there. So there seems that there is something else going on with the very massive planets around very massive stars and the red giant. So it seems that things that we knew they could constrain theory a little bit better are having problems with observation. So let's hope that gets better in the future.
Any more questions for Eva? If not, I actually have one that's maybe a quick one. I keep hearing people asking about second generation planets, and I think it's possible in binaries where you get a certain binary disk, but could you see any way to form second generation planets around a single white dwarf in the like after the planetary nebula?
I've been looking into this, and when you have disks, they are around binaries. And when you don't have disks, you don't have the surface density. So in a standard planet formation model, you will have it a little bit hard. You have to invoke kind of extreme scenarios. I'm not saying it's not possible. I'm saying that it's not going to go the standard way. And okay. In principle, when the standard wave, for the when we have clear disks observed in the pre-planetary nebula phase, these disks are around binary. So these are not observed in the white dwarf. We have kind of something strange going on there.
Okay. Okay, thanks again, Eva, for the nice overview talk.